Mr. True, today I want to talk to you about solving linear systems of equations. If you solve a linear system of equations, you are looking for where two lines cross. And there's three situations there. You can have two lines that never cross because they're parallel. That will be called no solution or inconsistent, which is a term that our new textbooks use. But no solutions when they're parallel and don't cross. You can have a situation where you have a line and then the other line lands right on top of it. That's going to be called mini solutions, or as our books call them, dependent. And then of course, as this one will, you can simply have a situation where, yes, the two points or two lines are going to cross at a certain x and y value, which we're going to find two ways with this one example. Now these that have one solution are kind of like normal and things kind of happen like you would expect. But for where you have two lines that are parallel, you're going to be solving your problems and all of a sudden everything's just going to go away. Like all the x's and y's are going to just disappear and you might have an answer like 0 equals 4. So all of a sudden it seems like you've done something wrong and what's left is a false statement. That is what happens when you're lines never cross. There is no solution, so you end up with a statement that is false, and that's the algebra going, those two lines are parallel, they never cross each other. If your two lines are laying right on top of each other, or called mini solutions or have a dependent, and I really prefer no solution, one solution, or mini solution, when you're solving these questions, and you won't see this example today, but you'll be doing your algebra work, and all the x's are just going to go poof and disappear. Well, when they do that, if you get a true statement like 0 equals 0 or 5 equals 5, then that means that it doesn't matter what your what x you plug in or what points you look along the lines, those two lines are sharing all of the same points because they're exactly the same line once they're graphed. So that's dependent or mini solution, and if you're doing your algebra and all the x's and y's just sort of disappear, then that is your case for many solutions. Let's find out where these two lines cross. Now, you have two or three, actually, methods of solving systems of equations. You can graph the lines through y equals mx plus b and just visually see where those two lines cross. That's not very accurate if the point is a difficult one, especially if there's decimals. So we have substitution method and linear combination method. I'm going to show you the substitution method first. Now the reason why this is a good fit for substitution method is because I have some terms whose leading coefficients are 1. Now I have two choices and it doesn't matter how I start. With substitution, your first step is to get one equation set equal to one variable. So I'm going to use the first one just because I felt like it. So 3x minus y equals 3, and I'm going to get this equation solved for the term with the leading coefficient of 1. I'm going to subtract both sides by 3x, and then get rid of the negative 1 in front of the y by dividing everything by negative 1. So y equals 3x minus 3. Great. That doesn't really tell me an answer because that's only the first step of doing substitution. Get an equation set equal to one of its variables. Step two is to take, you know, this expression that you have that now is either going to equal y or x, depending on whatever problem you're doing, and plug it into the other equation, the one that you haven't touched yet. So that's going to be the second one in this case. So it's going to be x, so this is step two, the actual substitution process, x plus 2 times y, or 2 times something. The y is a place where you plug stuff in, so I've taken the y out and put in a set of just parentheses, and in its place is 3x minus 3. And I'm going to solve this for the remaining variable, which in this case is x. So that is going to involve getting the distributive property going. X plus 6x minus 6 equals 8. Combine like terms if you got them. 7x minus 6 equals 8. I'm going to add 6 to both sides and get 7x equals, maybe I should show that. add 6 to both sides, and 7x equals 14, divide by 7, and x is equal to 2. And so this is my second step of doing the substitution method. Get one equation, solve for one of the variables, plug that into the other equation that you haven't worked with yet, and find half of your solution. Find the x, or in this, well, yeah, in this case it was the x of the coordinate where the two lines cross. Well, then how do you find the y? Because an x, you know, an intersection point is an x and a y value. Well, easy. Take this answer and plug it back into one of the original problems. So the third step of substitution is to take this answer and plug it back into one of the original ones. I'm going to pick the one with all positive numbers. X plus 2y equals 8. I'm going to plug in 2, so for x, so 2 plus 2y equals 8. I'm going to subtract both sides by 2, and you get 2y equals 6. Divide by 2, and I get y equals 3. So these two lines cross at the point of 2, 3. Bam! And if you saw a picture, that's where those two lines would be crossing. Now, let's see what that would look like through the linear combination process. Okay, now that was a substitution process. Go back and replay it and write down the steps that I verbally stated for the process of substitution. For the substitution method, you want to take one of the equation and get them equal to one of the variables. Solve for a variable that has a leading coefficient of 1, or just a coefficient of 1. Take your expression you found and plug it into the other equation. Solve for the remaining variable, and then plug your answer back into one of the original two equations. And it doesn't matter which of the two you pick. Substitution method is very, very powerful and sometimes is the best choice of solving a system of equations. However, if none of your coefficients are equal to 1 and they're all values, like this might be 4 and 5, and this might be 2 and that's already 2, if all your coefficients of x and y, if none of them are 1, then trying to solve by substitution method will cause you to use fractions and decimals through the whole process, which would really make things kind of complicated. So let's talk about the linear combination method. To do linear combination, what you want to do is just simply add those two equations and do it in such a way that one of the variables will cancel away. So, to do linear combination, what you want to do is look at your two equations and decide, well, what do I want to get rid of? Well, we're going to get rid of the y's first. So, once you decide with your linear combination method what variable you want to get rid of first, then your goal is to think of, okay, I want to multiply one or both of my equations by a number so that I create a pair of opposite numbers. And I want to do the same problem so you see I get the same answer again. So I have a negative 1 and a positive 2 in front of my y values, which I've just arbitrarily decided that's what I want to get rid of first. I need to do some kind of multiplication to create a pair of opposite numbers, so when I add I get 0. Well, I already have 2, and this negative 1, negative 1's are easy to change. If I have a positive 2 and I want this to be a opposite or negative 2, and I'm looking for the lowest common multiple, then what can I multiply negative 1 to get negative 2, the opposite of positive 2? Well, we're going to multiply that by positive 2. And I'm going to multiply this through the entire equation all the way through. So we're going to get 2 times 3, which is 6x, 2 times negative 1, which is negative 2y, and 2 times 3, which is 6. So everything in there got multiplied by 2. And now I'm just going to copy the second equation. X plus 2y equals 8. See the opposite numbers that are in front of the y that I arbitrarily decided I wanted to get rid of first? Once you get that opposite pair of numbers in front of one of the two variables, then you can add those equations and get 6 and 1 is 7x, 6 and 8 is 14, boom, just like that. So this is going to be a little bit less work than the example I just erased. 7x equals 14, I'm going to solve for x by undoing that multiplication by division, and x equals 2, the same answer as it was a minute ago. Okay, linear combination, one more time. Pick what variable you want to get rid of. Do some kind of multiplication to get that opposite pair of numbers that you want. Once you get those opposite numbers, you add the equations and then solve for the remaining variable. And that last step should be pretty quick. Okay, well this is one half of the point where the lines cross. I find the other half by once again plugging the x value, or y, if that's what you found, into one of the two original problems. And let's see. Let's pick the first one just to see if it matters, which one of these equations we use. 3 times 2 minus y equals 3. 3 times 2 is 6, which is minus y equals 3. Subtract both sides by 6. Negative y equals negative 3. Negative y means you have a negative 1 times y. You want to undo that multiplication, negative 1. You do that with division. And y equals 3, and guess what? That's exactly the same answer that we had a second ago. These two lines cross at the value of 2, 3. Okay, I got 3 minutes left. Let me do one more example before I get out of here. When you talk about linear equations, you have all these x's and y's floating around. That's all fine and dandy, but then you get something that almost seems too easy. Like 3x, well, not too easy, but there's stuff missing, which makes them confusing. So here's one equation and here's the other one. Solve this systems of equations. Now, linear combination, though I do prefer that method of solving a system of equations, would be horrible for this one. Maybe not horrible, but I think it'd be more confusing for students to try and figure this out. You know, sometimes we have ways that are good for teaching to make it less confusing, and then we have our own ways to do these problems that don't work well for teaching. Getting across what you're doing. So how do I take and do this problem through the substitution method? Well, the substitution method is, first, get an equation solved for one of the variables. Ha ha! I already got that. That's why substitution's good for this one. Second step. Take that expression where the y is by, you know, whatever variable you have, in this case y, where it's by itself, take its value and plug it into the other equation. So the substitution step here is I'm going to take the y, which is 5, and plug it into the other equation. So 3x minus 5 equals 4. That's 3x after I add both sides by 5, which some of you might need to see. And I should be doing as a teacher. And I want to undo the multiplication of 3. I'm going to do that with division. And where this line and this line cross, the x value is going to be 3. Well, what's the y value? Right there. It told me. Y is 5. So the point where these two lines cross is 3. 5. And I don't think I have time to draw this in the video, but this is just a normal line with some kind of slope. What kind of line do you get from y equals 5? What do those graphs look like? Don't forget, y equals a number is a horizontal line. This horizontal line is going to go through the y value of 5, and horizontal lines have a slope that's equal to 0. If that were x equals 5, x equals a number is a vertical line. They have an undefined slope because it's rise over the run value of 0, and you can't divide by 0. So y equals a number is a horizontal line, x equals a number is a vertical line, and if you have x and y's both in your equation, well then you just have a normal like y equals mx plus b line with the slope and y-intercept. All right, so solving systems of equations. If that wasn't enough examples, leave me a comment. I'll do another one and I'll do some more video examples for you, and I hope this helps. Woo! Have a great day.